Hey, what's going on? Instagram, Facebook world, YouTube, Bego, whatever platform that's watching right now, that's tuning into the video. Thank y'all, I appreciate it. Y'all know how we do. We always pray and then we'll read from the Father's Heart Ministry. And then right after that, we'll move forward into the lesson, which the lesson today is not everyone that is in your life is good for you. So I got some scriptures that I'm going to be bringing forth, and we'll dive more into this lesson. All right. So first and foremost, I just want to say thank you, Father, for waking me up, for allowing me to live to see another day that was not promised. Father, I thank you for your sons and your daughters that woke up today as well, Father God, that acknowledged you. And that's learning a new way in life, learning to be patient in life, learning how to forgive and let go, how to eliminate some people out of our lives, Father God, you know, because everything is a lesson and a blessing, Father God. There's some tests, there's some trials that we have to go through in order to know where you're taking us and what you're doing in our lives. So I thank you, Father, and I ask that you watch over them, you guide them, you protect them, keep them from hurt, all hurt, harm, and danger. That you encamp your warring angels and dispatch them around the world, Father God, from the north to the south, to the east, to the west, to that man or woman that's crying out to you right now, Father God, I pray and ask that you hear from them, Father God, and that you grant them their heart's desires. I pray that you watch over their children and keep them protected as well, Father God, as even a lot of our kids are out of school. Some of them are in summer school. But Father, I just pray that you continue to bless our homes, bless our lives, and show us the right way to go. In Jesus' mighty, holy, precious name, I pray. Amen. All right, so the Father's Heart Ministry. Shalawam, brothers and sisters, kings and queens. How y'all doing this evening? All right, let's go to the Father's Heart Ministry. And I wanna play, I'm gonna play a song that y'all might not like what I'm gonna play, but it goes right along with the message, you know. I try to find an edited version, so I'm probably just going to play the chorus. Most definitely, I want to just play the hook of this song. But first, we're going to read the Father's Heart Ministry. Hey, Bucci, how you doing, sister? The Father's Heart Ministry, we're going to read what the prophetic word says for today. And it says, do you know what I desire more than anything? Do you know what the Father desires more than anything? He desires you. He desires your time, your attention, and your friendship. He desires a relationship with you. He desires your time, your attention, your friendship, and your intercession. Your dreams and your desires, because all things make up our relationship. That's why I tell people all the time, it's not about religion. It's about a relationship with your Heavenly Father. A relationship. It's not just one-sided. And even though I know everything, even though the Father knows everything, it is the communing over your life and the impartation that comes when we fellowship and have that close time together that I really enjoy, that the Father really enjoys. That's just like a mother and a father today. When you spend time with your son or your daughter, you develop a relationship with them. Just having a child, just a man bringing the world, a child into the world, does not make you a father. Just a mother bringing a child into the world does not make you a mother. It makes you a mom and it makes you a dad. But to be a mother and a father, it takes time. To be that mother to your son, or a mother to your daughter, that father to your son, or father to your daughter, it takes a relationship. It takes spending time with them, praying with them, loving them, teaching them, showing them, because we're not born into this world knowing. You are not a robot. that I desire that you obey my every command while you fan me and feed me grapes. Yeah, he don't want us to fan him like, you know, the king, like you see on TV. They be fanning the king or fanning the man and feeding him grapes, tossing him in it. No, that ain't the type of relationship that he wants with you. I made the grapes and the palm fronds for you to enjoy. When you worship me with your whole heart, there is a melding that takes place that doesn't happen at any other time. There's something that's going to take place. Your faith ascends to a place of confident trust that causes us to become one. My spirit within you is energized when you worship and pray and intercede, because you are joining with me for a common purpose as it unfolds to you. You are joining yourself with the Heavenly Father as it unfolds right before your eyes. As life is unfolding right before your eyes, you are developing a relationship with Him where you can hear from Him. It is more than something I desire. It actually produces something within you and within the people and the atmosphere around you that is powerful and effective. The atmosphere that's around me, that's around you. When you're in the relationship with your Heavenly Father, your atmosphere will change. There'll be some rearranging of some things. There'll be some pruning, away at some things. Praise still the Avenger because he cannot penetrate the atmosphere of faith. Of faith and the force field of worship. The praise stops the enemy, the Avenger, because he cannot penetrate the atmosphere that you're in. Or the faith of the force field that's around you. He can't penetrate that. In this, he has no weapons to fight with. When you're in God's presence, when you're in the atmosphere, when you're with God, when God is inside of you, when he dwells in you, when he speaks through you, the enemy can't dwell within you. He can't even sit around you. He can't even fellowship with you. In this, he has no weapons to fight with. In worship, you are submitted to me, and so when you resist, he must flee. When you resist, he has to flee. You have authority in the earth, just as Jesus used his authority. By what? By saying, "It is written," when he was tempted of the devil, you have the same authority. Your weapons are mighty. My word is living, active, and full of power, sharper than any two-edged sword, penetrating as far as the division of the soul and the spirit, the completeness of a person, and of both joints and marrow, the deepest parts of our nature, exposing and judging the very thoughts and intentions of the heart. The angels hearken to the voice of my word. They are listening. So what are you saying? The angels are listening to us. They're keeping track of everything that we say. What are you saying? Are you telling the enemy what to do? Are you kicking the enemy out of your life, out of your household, out of your body, out of your temple? Are you delivered or are you just saved? Are you just saved by grace? Anybody can be saved, but are you delivered? So says the Father. All right, where my book at? So, not everyone that's in your life is good for you. Put my thumb all the way on that mug. Some are blessings and some are lessons. Some are blessings and some are lessons to be learned. Go to Jeremiah 29 and 11. I gotta grab my Bible. I had it, but I don't know where it went. Oh, there it go. Jeremiah 29 and 11. Jeremiah 29, 11, it says, "For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, saith the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end." God has a plan for your life, and it's to bless you, not to kill you, not to curse you, but to bless you, because he loves you. He will do this work through family, friends, pastors, co-workers, bosses, you name it. God will use anybody. He will use people to bless you, to do his work. He will call them to you. He will tell them to bless you, to gift you, to help you. But guess who also does something, who sends people towards you too? The enemy. He does this through his people. He will put you on their heart to bless you. He will put people, he will put you on their hearts, on their mind to bless you, to help you in that time of need. It don't always have to be in finances. It could be words of encouragement. It could be to warn you of something. Just like the Most High God has a plan for your life, the enemy, Satan, Lucifer, the devil, has a plan for your life as well. He has a plan for your life. He is going to try and imitate God by bringing or sending people in your life to use you and to destroy you. So some are sent by God and others are sent by anti-God. The devil. Just like how the Most High God removed the enemy out of the kingdom, just like how God removed the enemy out of the kingdom, how he kicked him out, you're gonna have to kick somebody out of your life. You're gonna have to let some people go, because everybody ain't for you. Everybody don't love you. Everybody don't want the best for you. Some of them want to use you. Some of them want to kill you. Some of them want to condemn you. Go to Revelation chapter 12, verse 9. I'm gonna tell you how you know that God kicked them out. And we got to kick some people out too. Hold on. Revelation 12 and 9. And we just piggybacking on what we talked about yesterday. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil. He was cast out of where? And Satan, which deceived the whole world, he was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, "Now has come salvation and strength, and the kingdom of our God, and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night." We gonna have to kick some people out of our lives. Some devils out of your life. Because they will dress themselves up as they are meant for you, and they want to help you, but all the while they want to take from you. They want to use you. They want to use your platform. You are going to have to remove folks out of your life and circle too. You're going to have to get some people out of your life and out of your circle. Because everybody can't go. This ain't for everybody. Some folks will walk away from you, but be okay with that. Be okay with that. Uh-oh, it's saying my phone is going dead. Let me put this on the charger real quick. It's always something. Always something. Hold on one second. I'm just plugging this joint up. Gotta make sure that the word can still come forth. All right, so we on the charger now. My bad, y'all, we on two platforms. So I had to make sure this one is on the charger. The other one is pretty much charged up. Where was I? You are going to have to remove folks out of your life and circle too, because they are plotting against you and their father sent them. Y'all gotta know that God sends people and the devil sends people too. He sends people in your life. And I'm gonna show you in the word. Check it out. I'm gonna show you in the word. Go with me to John chapter 8, verse 44. John chapter 8, verse 44. Verse 44, you are of your father, the devil, and the lust of your father you will do. He was a murderer from the beginning and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speak a lie, he speak of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it. And because I tell you the truth, you believe me not. This is Christ talking. Which of you convince me of sin? He said, which one of y'all convinced me of sin? And if I say the truth, why do you not believe me? Christ said, why do y'all don't believe me? I'm telling you the truth. He that is of God hears God's words. You therefore hear them not, because you are not of God. So understand, you are going to have some devils in your life that are going to come to you and say, oh, this ain't the truth. That Bible ain't real. That stuff ain't real. Heaven ain't real. Hell ain't real. God ain't real. Jesus ain't. That's what they'll say. But we know the truth. We know who they are. So we don't have to compete with that. We know who they are. Get thee from me, Satan. Keep on preaching and teaching the word. Keep on opening the eyes of the people. Keep on doing God's will for your life, his purpose for your life. Keep on being about your father's business. Some people are too toxic for you, and you have to eliminate them. God will show you who he sent and who the enemy sent. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 14. Be you not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion has light with darkness? And what concord has Christ with Belial? Or what part hath he that believed with an infidel? What business do you have fellowshipping with unbelievers? What business do you have going where you know you shouldn't be going? What business do you have going to the club and hanging out with folks doing sinful things when you know right from wrong? What business do you have listening to somebody telling you that you can have a side piece? What business do you have listening to somebody to tell you to kill somebody when you know right from wrong? What business do you have fellowshipping with them? What business do you have fellowshipping with unbelievers? This verse alone should tell you that you won't be able to hang with unbelievers or what they do, because darkness can't stand light. Darkness cannot stand the light. I'll tell you how. Flip on the switch when it's dark and watch the darkness disappear, or run and go and hide. Try to find a place to hide. But the light will overpower it. What am I saying? When you in this truth, when you following Christ, which is he followed, listened to his heavenly father, darkness don't want to be around you. It will try and come and get you back into darkness, but it don't want to be around you. When you start saying it is written, when you start saying what the word of God says, people get to moving around. They can't listen to it. They will remove themselves. You won't have to remove them. They'll remove themselves. But keep on doing what you're doing. Because God is showing you something. God is trying to tell you something. Evil does not like good. We are social people with most people. Y'all know we social. We socialize on these platforms all the time. We socialize with somebody. We socialize when we go to work. We socialize when we go to school. We socialize wherever we go. If you go to the store, you socializing with somebody. Because either you talking to somebody right in front of you, or you talking to somebody on the phone. You socialize. You have a relationship with pretty much everyone you encounter in life. But what type of relationship did you gain with them? Is it good or evil? You have a relationship with everybody. Sorry about this chair, y'all. It's a little squeaky. But you got a relationship with everybody. What type of relationship do you have with them? What type of relationship do they have with you? What type of relationship do they have with God, with the Most High God? That's the type of relationship. Those are the type of people I want to be around. Those that know the word. Those that's living the word. Those that want a better life. A life that's better than the one that we've been living. That's the type of relationship I want with my brothers and sisters. Even with my sons and my daughters. I want that type of relationship with them, so I give it to them. I want that type of relationship with a wife, with my wife, and not with everybody else. I want that with her. I want to do that with her. Huh. God showed you the relationship you are going to have with these type of individuals, but we didn't pay attention to the signs. We ignored them and didn't use our spirit of discernment. Sort of like Samson. Do you know the story of Samson? Go to Judges chapter 16. Judges chapter 16, and let's start at the 16th verse. Judges chapter 16, starting at the 16th verse. Doom, 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 doom. And I'm still going to play that song for y'all. All right. Chapter 16. Man, these pages are so stuck together. All right. Judges chapter 16. Verse 16. Let's start there. And it came to pass, when she pressed him daily with her words and urged him so that his soul was vexed unto death, that he told her all his heart and said unto her, there hath not come a razor upon mine head, for I have been a Nazarite unto God from my mother's womb. If I be shaven, then my strength will go from me, and I shall become weak, and I will be like any other man. And when Delilah saw that he had told her all his heart, she sent and called for the lords of the Philistines, saying, come up,
this once, for he hath showed me all his heart. Then the lords of the Philistines came unto her, up unto her, and brought money in their hand. So they gave her money to do what? To take this man's power from him. To deceive him. But see, if he had been listening to the voice of the Lord, instead of looking how beautiful this woman was, instead of over here with this Philistine, instead of with a Nazirite, and telling her all his secrets and everything about him, then he would have never lost his power. But guess what? Some of us fall into the same stuff. Some of us fall into the same stuff. Instead of listening to God, we go and listen to someone else. Instead of listening to mama and daddy, when mama and daddy tell you no, or mama tells you no, son, that's not the woman for you. You still do it anyway. I know I did. Because I was so attracted to this woman because she was fine as wine. Because she was too hot to trap. Because couldn't nothing touch her with a 10-foot pole. But all the while I'm with her, she conspiring against me. She's using me. But it be the same thing for the women too. The men will come into your life just to use you, to abuse you, to take from you, but not give to you. Not give right for you. They'll give you hell, insecurities. They'll pour those seeds inside of you. And women too. We all do it to one another because we don't be listening to God. You think about the relationships that you have been in. Think about it. You've been in some relationships that tried to break you. And mama told you. Daddy might have told you. But you stayed with this man or you stayed with this woman, knowing that you should have left. But you know what? It's a part of your journey. It's a part of your testimony. It's a part of the process of crying out to God, of surrendering to the Most High God. It's a part of your journey. Somebody can tell you all day today, blue in the face. But you know what? It's only up to you to listen or not to. Now, no pointing fingers, none of that, because we all have come short of the glory of God, you know? We all have not listened to mama at one point in time, not listened to daddy at one point in time, not listened to God at one point in time. But you know what? You can listen now. You can make that covenant with God that, Father, I'm going to listen to you. I'm going to listen to you fully. I'm going to stay in the word. I'm going to seek first the kingdom and your righteousness and your glory will be added to me. I'm going to do this daily. I'm not just going to do this on Sunday. I'm not just going to do this on Wednesday. I'm not just going to do this on Tuesday. I'm going to do this every day. Listen here. Now, if Samson would have just done what he was supposed to do and not told Delilah these things, he would have still had his hair. He would have still had his power. But he gave away his secret to a woman that he fell in love with, but really it was lust. Because she meant him no good. You don't have a choice in the matter of who your father or your mother is. You don't have that choice. You don't have that choice once you're planted inside of the mother. You don't have the choice of who your mother or your father is. But what you do have the choice of is who you allow in your life. The mother or father, the parent, has a choice on who her man is going to be, who the father of her children is going to be. The father has a choice of who the mother of his children is going to be. in the way that they raise their children up. But what kind of relationship do you have with that woman or that man you lie down with? Do you know if they know God? Do you know if they have a relationship with God? Do you know any of those things? Or did you just lie down with them because the way they looked, the way they spoke, how big her butt was, how big her breast was, how big his penis is, or how tall he is, or, oh, he's going to the NFL, he's going to the NBA, he's going to be somebody, and that's somebody I want to be with. But did you really get to know that person? Did you really try to get to know this man or this woman? Did y'all study together? Did y'all work together? Did y'all go to church together? Did y'all go out on dates? And I'm not talking about just for sex. I'm talking about spending time with one another. Did y'all have quality time with one another to see if this is the man that I want to lie down with, or if this is the woman that I want to call my wife, the mother of my children, my queen? Is this the man that you want to call king? You do have a choice of who you fellowship with, like friends, family, loved ones. That's your choice in life. But my advice to you is choose carefully who you want and desire to be with, because if they are not sent by the Most High God, they are sent by the devil. Delilah wasn't sent by God for Samson. That was of the enemy, just for money. And we see that all the time on television. We see people joking about it. They want you for your money. They want you because you rich. They want you because you're a celebrity. But they never knew you. Like, you wasn't always a celebrity. You wasn't always on television. But now that you're on television, now they want to be with you. Now they see you. Now they want you. Oh, girl, look at him. He on television now. Look at him. I didn't even think he was going to make it. Girl, I need to go holler at him. I remember when he tried to holler at me. Or it could be the woman on TV. Man, look, man, she finally made it. Look at that. I dropped her like a bad habit. She wasn't even looking good, man. But look at her now. She done changed. Got her hair done. Her teeth fixed. Got a little junk in the trunk behind her. Now you want to be with her. Why? You don't even know her. You didn't try to get to know her. Why do you want to be with her? Because she popular, or because he popular? Come on, man. When you walk away from this world or the devilish ways, he can't use you anymore. When you learn the right way to go, he can't use you anymore. He can't use you to destroy people. He can't use you to kill people. He can't use you to transgress the law. So he sends people to come against you, to get you to doubt who God is. God is calling you. He's calling you to him to bless you, not to curse you. Deuteronomy chapter 28. Verse 8 through 12. Hold on. Before I do that, I want to play a song for y'all. Now, please don't take offense to it. But this song, it relates to a lot of this message today. It does. And I'm pretty sure you're going to love it. Hold on one second. I'm pretty sure y'all going to know this song. Hold on. That's a commercial. That ain't what I'm trying to play. y'all, please excuse the language. I could not find it in a clean version or an edited version, so please excuse the language. Y'all know this song, but like I said, just please excuse the language.
We match all the cash.
Well, you got another ad coming.
Your first year.
All right, here we go.
When I first played
Five,
my old page,
four,
I started getting this one.
Two,
I put
one.
Tons of pictures.
All right. I'm sorry for the language. I apologize in advance.
Why the funny nigga wanna go get the girl? Why the funny nigga wanna drag a nigga name? Superstar. I know some niggas who hurt,
they hurt.
A couple bitches who hurt,
they hurt.
The language.
They don't want me to make it. The DA, I know that he
working.
Prosecutors wanna help me.
What?
Hold on, they don't do me dirty.
Before they
got to be dirty. Shoot on, boy, she's perfect.
What?
I got a 100 on me. Devil ride me in my sleep. I break a bitch in the week. Look, bitch, I'm not what you think.
Money is home, turn his back on.
Everybody ain't your friend. Everybody ain't your partner. Everybody ain't no real nigga. If I say I got you, I got you. When it's fucked up and get fucked up, just hold it down and keep it silent. And when you're not around, I protect your name. I won't let a nigga talk about you. Everybody ain't your friend. Everybody ain't your partner.
All right. So the reason I played that song, I ain't gonna play the whole thing, but the reason I played that song is because that's true. Everybody ain't your friend and everybody ain't your partner. Everybody don't want you to make it. Everybody not gonna be there for you. Some people just wanna take from you. You imagine if a lot of us actually applied this to our lives and stopped spending time with folks that don't mean us any good and walk away from them? Imagine how great a lot of these folks would be. Like Tupac, he was told to move around away from Suge, but he stayed near Suge. And what happened? He was warned, but he stayed near him and he lost his life for it. Eazy-E was told to quit messing, rocking with some stuff, messing with things. And what happened? He lost his life for it. Tupac's mama told him that the world was going to give him everything to destroy him. And what happened? It did. Nipsey Hussle. I'm just giving y'all a few of them. Nipsey Hussle. It was some folks he should have just walked away from. He shouldn't have been around. Some folks he shouldn't even converse with no more. But it brought him to his demise. And in everyday life, that happens to a lot of us. Some of these kids out here, some of us out here, the people we've been hanging around, the people we've been fellowshipping with, the people we've been trying to be cool with, ain't really about that life. Don't really mean you any good. When you get locked up in prison, is they there for you? Heck no. But you know who be there for you? Mama, daddy, family, putting money on your books, sending you letters. But when you get out, them friends, if they ain't dead or had to go to prison as well, they be right there, ready to bring you right back down. Come on, man. Come on, man. Let's go see some hoes. Let's go to the strip club. Let's go snort a line. Let's go do some drugs. Let's go smoke. Brother, I'm on probation. I'm on parole. I can't get in trouble no more. That's what they should be saying. Like, oh man, you soft. Like, what happened to you, cuz? What happened to you, blood? You still down, Nick? Like, what? I just served a 5-year bid or a 10-year bid of 15 years. And you want to ask me if I want to come out and do the same thing to go right back up in there? Is you crazy? Bruh, I can't even hang around you no more, man. I gotta shake the spot. I got kids out here. I got a family out here that I gotta protect. I got sons that I gotta keep from going the way that I went. I got a daughter who I don't want her to be with a man that I was before I went in there. I gotta show her. I gotta tell her. I gotta help more than just them. I gotta talk to other young men, because there was a lot of young men up in there
that had the same story. And some of them ain't gonna get out. Some of them ain't gonna make it. Because they come in there and they still about that life. Or, excuse me, trying to be about that life. Deuteronomy 28, chapter, or Deuteronomy chapter 28, verses 8 through 12. Chapter 28. Eight through 12. This is what it said. The Lord shall command the blessing upon you in your storehouses and in all that thou settest thine hand unto. And he shall bless thee in the land which the Lord thy God will give you. God is going to bless you. You're going to have to kick some people out your life, but hey, don't trip. Some family ain't going to rock with you. Some friends ain't going to rock with you. Because what did Mo 3 say? Everybody ain't your friend. And everybody ain't your partner. Everybody ain't. But you will know them by their fruits. But God is getting ready to bless you. But you're going to have to let some things go. He can't bless you when you still got unbelievers around you, because they trying to get what God has given you. They trying to take from you. They trying to take from God. What God is getting ready to do in your life, it ain't for them. It's for you. It's not for everybody. It's for you. But what are you going to do when you get it? Are you going to remain humble? Are you going to remain this man or woman of God? Are you going to stay this servant of the Lord? Are you going to continue to preach and teach the word? Are you going to help people? Or are you going to be uppity and prideful and feel like you got it all together? Nah. You got to stay the same. You got to stay the same way with God. You got to keep on elevating and changing for the better to bless somebody, because somebody was just like you before, and you may be the Christ that they need to see in their life, the one that they need to hear from. The Lord shall establish thee a holy people unto himself. He hath sworn unto you, if thou shalt keep the commandments of the Lord thy God and walk in his ways, and all people of the earth shall see that thou art called by the name of the Lord, and they shall be afraid of you. The people will begin to see. When God starts to bless you, when the world be able to see it, especially on these platforms, they gonna know that it was nothing but God. They gonna know that you can't mess with that brother. You can't mess with that sister. That man is walking in the power of God. That woman is walking in the power of God, of her heavenly Father. Do not mess with them. Leave them alone. And the Lord shall make you plenteous in goods and in the fruit of your body and in the fruit of your cattle and in the fruit of the ground and in the land which the Lord sware unto thy fathers to give thee. Your fathers would be your ancestors, the ones that came out of Egypt and went into the wilderness. And they didn't get this land because they wasn't ready for the temptation that was coming towards them. They wasn't ready. They got delivered from all these things, and they still wasn't ready. It wasn't for them. It's for us. It's for us that diligently seek him. For us that obey the commands. For us that are going to continue to help people and to bless people at the same time. To allow God to do it through you. To listen to God when he says to give to that man. Give to that woman. Help that child in the time of need. give them some words of encouragement. Push them, help them. The Lord shall open unto you his good treasure, the heaven to give the rain unto thy land in his season, and to bless all the work of thine hand, and thou shalt lend unto many nations, and thou shalt not borrow. That's what God is getting ready to do for me. I'm ready for that, Lord. He's going to bless everything that I have touched, everything that I have done. He's getting ready to do something to where I'm going to be able to bless other people, other nations, to help them in a mighty way. I'm not going to need to get a PPP loan. Why? When I can get everything from God. Because he's getting ready to bless me. He's getting ready to do some things. Bless you. He's getting ready to do some marvelous work. And all we got to do is give him praise, honor, and glory. And thank him in advance. And thank him when you get it. And keep on acknowledging him. Go with me to Isaiah 40 and 31. Isaiah 40 and 31. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint. They that renew their strength. They that wait upon the Lord, he will renew our strength. He will renew you in a mighty way. You will mount up like an eagle that has wings. You will stand tall and stand firm. Ain't nothing gonna break you. You will run and you will not get tired. You will walk and you will not faint. You will receive some blessings. I'm telling you, like, you will receive the strength, the power of God. Won't nothing be able to touch you with a 10-foot pole. As long as you continue to wait on God. Wait on God for that man that's supposed to be in your life. Wait on God for that woman that's supposed to be your wife. Wait on God for your blessings. And don't get discouraged. Don't get off course. And if you do get off, make sure you get right back on. Get right back on that trail. Don't run away from it. Get right back on it. Pick up where you left off at. Just like you do when you're watching a movie or you're watching a TV show, you pause it and you come right back to where you left at. Do the same thing in life. Pick up where you left off at. Get right back to it. Let's go to Psalms 27, 11 through 14. Amen. Amen. Hope y'all receiving this message, man. It's a blessing and lessons at the same time. Psalms 27, 11 through 24. Or I said 24, 14, I apologize. 11 through 14. Teach me thy way. Teach me the way, O Lord, Father, and lead me. What the heck is that book? Lead me in a plain path because of mine enemies. Deliver me not unto the will of mine enemies. Lead me, guide me, protect me. Don't leave me in their will. Deliver me from that. Deliver me not over unto the will of mine enemies, for false witnesses are risen up against me, and such as breathe out cruelty. I had fainted unless I had believed to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait on the Lord, be of good courage, and he shall strengthen your heart. Wait, I say, wait on God, wait on the Lord. Wait. Don't be impatient, but gain patience. Learn patience. Psalms 37, 7 through 9, and then I got one more and I'll be done. Psalms 37, 7 through 9. For evildoers shall be cut off. Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for him. There it is again. Patience. Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for him. Fret not thyself because of him who prospereth in his way. Because the man who brings wicked devices to pass, cease from anger and forsake wrath. Fret not thyself in any wise to do evil. Cease from anger and forsake your wrath in that time. You don't need to argue with anybody. You don't need to cuss nobody out. Cease from that. Hold your tongue. Learn that no answer is the best answer. Just because they talk down about you and they say stuff against you, you don't need to say nothing. Keep on going. Because they want you to get angry. They want you to get frustrated. They want you to cuss them out. They want to say, see, I told you, he wasn't about that life. She ain't about that life. Look at them using words that they shouldn't be using. Patience. Patience is a virtue. For evildoers shall be cut off, but those that wait upon the Lord shall inherit what? The earth. Evildoers are going to be cut off. They are not going to receive their inheritance. They will be cut off. But for us that wait on God, we shall receive our inheritance and inherit the earth. Last but not least, for those that's messing with God's chosen people, for those that's coming towards them, I got a message for you. Touch not his anointed. Psalms 105, verse 15. And then we're going to close it out. Don't speak against God's anointed. Don't put your hands on him. Don't put your mouth on him. Don't do nothing to him. Because God don't play about his anointed. His anointed sons and daughters. It's going to be hell to pay when you mess with them. 105 verse 15, saying, touch not mine anointed, and do my prophets no harm. Moreover, he called for a famine upon the land. He brake the whole staff of bread. He sent a man before them, even Joseph, who was sold for a servant, whose feet they hurt with fetters. He was laid in iron until the time that his word came. The word of the Lord tried him. The king sent and loosed him. Even the ruler of the people let him go free. He made him lord of his house and ruler of all his substance, to bind his princes at his pleasure and to teach his senators wisdom. Israel also came into Egypt, and Jacob sojourned in the land of Ham. See, this is why he say, touch not his anointed. Because they did all those things to him, but they had to let him go. And guess what? He became ruler of the house. He became the king at that point in time. He became the one who was teaching the ones who was over him. He became the one who was giving them the wisdom, the knowledge, and understanding. Even his brothers who sold him, he was ruler over them. They had to come to him for food. They had to come to him for stuff. Touch not his anointed. Because eventually, you're going to have to come to the one that you used to talk about, to the one that you used to persecute, the one you used to judge, the one you used to ridicule and condemn. You're going to have to come to him. You're going to have to come to her and be humble. And you're going to have to ask for something, because you're about to lose some things as well. The first shall be last, and the last shall be first. Hey, man, I didn't mean to be before y'all too long. I hope y'all received something with this message. Shalawam, brothers and sisters, kings and queens. Father, I thank you for the word. I thank you for your children being here, fellowshipping with me, studying the word together, Father God, as we continue to seek your face, your kingdom, and the righteousness so that we can have our inheritance. So that we will be blessed openly, Father God, so we can show people the way, so we can show people how to acknowledge you and why we should stop acknowledging all these other things which you created. Why we should stop making money our God. Why we should stop making a man our God, or a woman our God, or a house our God, or a car our God. But we should make sure that you are the God of all. You are the creator of it all. You created all things, and all you want to do is bless us and to give us our inheritance. But we must first learn the way. We must first learn patience, as Christ was a patient man, is a patient man. We must first learn to love one another, to help one another, to serve one another. Because in serving one another, we are serving you. We are pleasing you. And we want to make sure that we do it all in the right way and no longer the wrong way, because the world has shown us how to go the wrong way in life. And Father, we just want to do what's right and pleasing to you, because we desire to hear those words. Job well done, my good and faithful servant, my son or my daughter. And not the words of, depart from me, you workers of iniquity, because I never knew you. Father, we love you, we praise you, we magnify you, we glorify you. Father, teach us how to love you more every day, how to obey you fully, how to put this word back into our lives and in the lives of our children, in our lives of our sons and our daughters, in the lives of our friends, in the lives of our brothers and our sisters. We thank you, we praise you. We give you all honor, glory, and praise. In Jesus Christ's mighty, holy, and precious name, we pray. And everybody said, amen. So be it. Amen and amen. Shalawam, kings and queens, brothers and sisters. I love y'all. Blessings to y'all. Knowledge.